I looked at a quote just the other day, and if it'll come. Anyway, the quote really said, in fact, it's really on your sheet there, so maybe I didn't even have it on the slides, but it says, a church without the broken is actually a broken church. There's so much truth to that, and if you've been around Saylorville at all, you understand that is the direction that we're headed. We understand that we're broken people, and we're trying to reach out to a world that is very broken. And so I pray that God would always give us a heart of encouragement and desire to do that. That should be a part of our DNA. You know, as you look back at the last several weeks as far as what has taken place, if you look at your, if you have a worksheet or if you're following along, 2 weeks ago, Brad covered the community with Christ, and I put down enjoyable because that truly should be true, shouldn't it? That we as believers just delight and love to spend time with Christ alone. It always gives me a great joy, at least in my family, to watch a daughter or a son or even my wife just reading the Word of God in the morning and spending time with Him. And that should be a great joy to us. That is the kernel and the center of our community. Our time alone with Christ is crucial to any spiritual growth. And Brad covered that, and I pray that you're finding delight in that and you have an organized way of doing that. But my question is, if that's all a person were to do, how deep and how spiritual would that person be if that's the only community that they had? If that's all they did was spend time with Christ and never spent any time in these other areas that God is interested in. And I would guess all of us know people that may represent believers, but no, we don't really need church. We're not all about that. We have the Lord. And how deep spiritually do those people go? I've known some, they've never impressed me spiritually. Because that's not what God intended. Then a week ago, Pat talked about community with believers, and that as well should be a great delight, should it not? We should enjoy coming together. In fact, one of the things I've remarked over the last several weeks, sometimes I stand out in the back after Sunday night, and it's like nobody wants to leave. I mean, everybody is just staying around. To any pastoral staff, that actually is a delight for us. Because we sense that people aren't just coming to church because of obligation. They want to be there. Not only do they want to be there, they want to connect with other people. That's the way it should be. That's the way it should be. And I always joke when I was down in Ecuador, I would have to run a van to take people home after church. One, we had trouble getting them out of church. We almost say, hey, we gotta go. And then once they got in the van, everybody said, I want to go home last. I said, that's not gonna work, you know. But it really was refreshing to hear that because I could sense they just wanted to spend time together. And that person certainly would have more depth because they have community with other believers. We learn from one another. We carry one another's burdens. We rejoice. We weep together. We grow together. We need each other. And I know Jason sometimes accuses me of taking over his job of cell group leader because I assign people wherever I can. I'll be honest. As soon as I meet somebody and they're not connected to a group, I want to put them in a group. And sometimes I don't go by Jason and I need to. I understand that. But people need to be in groups with one another just to learn, just to learn. But I have another question here. You know, the first group, he said, boy, if he's just with Christ and never with other believers, how deep do they really go? And then I can ask another question as far as community. If we just have Christ and then the community of believers, and that's as far as it goes, is that all that God really desires? Because there's a third community, the one we're going to cover tonight, the community with unbelievers. And I just want to say, oftentimes we're so comfortable in the first two, we don't want to address the third community. I'm going to tell you right now, that's what not Saylorville is not about that. We want to include that third community. And you know, when you think about it, this is my personal experience. If you just exist in the first two communities, you lack depth in your spiritual life. I'm going to just say that's been my experience, and I think scriptures would point to that as well. I know sometimes it's a struggle to reach out to a community that knows nothing and doesn't live according to the precepts of God. That can be hard, but really that's what God has designed, hasn't he? Let me just read, just listen. I didn't put the verses on the worksheet, but here's Romans chapter 9. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience is testifying to me with the Holy Spirit that I have intense sorrow and continual anguish in my heart. For I could almost wish to be cursed and cut off from the Messiah for the benefit of my brothers, my own flesh and blood. Do you sense a depth in Paul that sometimes we wonder if we've ever arrived there? You know the story of Jesus as he sat over Jerusalem. And he literally wept over Jerusalem and said, "How often I would have gathered you." You see, he was going to do community, yes, with his disciples, but it went beyond that, didn't it? There's another passage. Maybe I just have you turn there to Colossians if you have a Bible, because there's a favorite character that I have there called Epaphras or Epaphras, however you want to pronounce it, but he's mentioned in the letter to the Colossians, and he brought the gospel to them. You find that in chapter 1 when it says that the gospel, the truth of the gospel at the end of 5, that has come to you and is bearing fruit and growing all over the world, just as it is among you since the day you heard it and recognized the grace in the truth. You learned this from Epaphras, our own dearly loved fellow slave or servant. He is faithful servant of the Messiah on your behalf. Epaphras brought the gospel to Colossae. Now, look at chapter 4 once, because Paul has a few other words that he speaks about this man, but he's very involved in the lives of these people at Colossae. He writes in Colossians 4:12, "Epaphras, who is one of you, a slave of Christ Jesus, greets you. He is always contending for you in his prayers." We had a speaker a Sunday ago on Sunday morning that talked about laboring in prayers. Can I say the first question I had? I don't know the speaker. I wonder if he does that. I'm not saying if he did or did not, but then I thought of the whole Christian community. Do we really know what it is to labor intensely in prayer for people who don't even know the Lord and for believers as well? Because I think there's a whole dimension when you take part in this third community of the unbelievers, it adds something to your spiritual depth. There's intensity and there's passion. There's disappointment and encouragement. You see, God really wanted us to be a part of all three of those communities. And if you're not participating in this third one, believe me, God desires for you to be deeper in your walk as you reach out to people and share your life with them. So tonight we want to talk a little bit about this third community, and as we look at it, there are several things I think are essential, and that deals with gratitude. That's the first, if you wanted to write something on number one, is gratitude. Gratitude should drive us into that third community. It's a mandate from the Lord. I understand that. Go into all of the world. But, you know, gratitude should be the driving force. And maybe one of my favorite characters in the Bible is Ruth. And some of her statements in her book speak about a deep gratitude when she first came into Israel. Notice, as Boaz took note of her and was helping her, she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me? I'm a foreigner." You can almost sense she's overwhelmed that someone would even take note of her. She goes on to say in that same passage, "Then she said, I found favor in your eyes, my Lord, to you who have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants." She's overwhelmed with the action that was coming to her. She was filled with gratitude. It always reminds me of the New Testament verse in Ephesians. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Every person in this room, if you know Christ, should be overwhelmed that God would even think on you. Your heart should be filled with gratitude towards Him, and that gratitude should grow. That's so important as you think of an unlovely world. What is going to push you out there? The gratitude of what God has done for you and remembering the person God used to bring you into the family of God. That gratitude needs to be deep, and it should, and you should reflect on it often. We should be overwhelmed by what God has done on our behalf. There's another scene in the book of Matthew that underscores this very thing, and I just use it as a text to sort of launch on. Remember Matthew when he was a tax collector? The Lord came to him and said, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." He didn't say it to Matthew, that was more to Peter, but at the same call that came to Matthew when he was at the tax office, and he wanted Matthew to follow him. And the result was is that Matthew threw a great banquet, it says in the book of Luke. And the verses, though, are here. As Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, which meant he was a lower tax collector than many as he worked directly with the people. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he arose and he followed him. And as Jesus reclined at the table in the house, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and were reclining with Jesus and his disciples. Now notice Matthew in the very testimony as you think through this passage. And I know we don't have a lot of time, but I jotted just a few notes about Matthew as you look at it, you know. He was called into the ministry as he was faithfully doing his secular job here. And for a while, we know that he lived in the secular setting. And we know, as you consider his life, at some point, Matthew had chosen tax collecting and money over spiritual life. That has to be true. Matthew knew when he got involved in this job, he was going to forfeit going to the temple. He was going to forfeit going to the synagogue. He was going to be an outcast of his very heritage. So I know that Matthew loved material things at least for a while in his life. But obviously there was turmoil that was going on in Matthew's life way before Jesus ever came. Because when Jesus finally showed up and said, "Follow me," this wasn't the first time he heard about Jesus. He had heard about Jesus numbers of times in that area of Galilee. And I think what you have in Matthew is he got involved in a job. He didn't know how to escape. He didn't know what to do, but he was not content there. He had realized that the secular, the money world was not going to give to him the joy that he thought it would. And I'm convinced that Matthew was saying, "Oh God, if my life could just count for something, I just don't know how to get there." And when Jesus came by and called a tax collector, Matthew was beside himself because this was, in the Jewish terms, this was absurd. A tax collector, a follower of this Messiah. And I just say, as you look at Matthew here, I think he was overwhelmed with gratitude. And I say that because immediately he takes his house, and Matthew doesn't even say it's his house. The other gospel writers tell us that. He sets aside his house and he uses his house, he prepares food, he invites the down and outers, he invites all of his friends, he wants them to come in. He is filled with gratitude. And he moves forward in order to share Jesus with them. I don't know if Matthew knew exactly how to share as much as he just wanted him to be around Jesus and his disciples. He wanted to bring this believing group with all of his friends. He wanted so that they would dialogue together. He certainly did have gratitude, which led to a great desire. That's the second word, the second blank. The great desire to serve God. And then the third one is it led him to action. And you know, as you look at it, you can sense there was a conflict in Matthew because of the gospel writers. Matthew made more references to the Old Testament than Mark and Luke and John put together, which causes me to think, what did he do? He couldn't go to the synagogue, which meant Matthew probably studied at home, learning, longing, yet not escaping, and when the call came, he was ready to go. There was a struggle, but the Lord led him to that place. And I would say to you, you have a secular job, and I remember I worked in the secular world for quite a while, but the longing of my heart was, "Oh God, I just want my life to count for something." And I pray that you have that desire. It doesn't mean you have to leave your secular work, but I hope that desire is there, because that's what Matthew had, filled with gratitude, leading to a desire, and then into action. That was a great example to me, to desire and then to action. This is what it does say about Matthew towards, and this comes out of John MacArthur. We know that Matthew wrote the gospel with a Jewish audience in mind. Tradition says he ministered to the Jews both in Israel and abroad for many years before being martyred for his faith. There is no reliable record of how he was put to death, but earlier traditions indicate he was burned at the stake. Thus, this man who walked away from a lucrative career without ever giving a second thought remained willing to give his life for Christ to the very end. I pray that that is your desire. He certainly worked in the unbelieving as well as the believers. Many of you may have never seen the picture of this man before. His name's Doug. This is the man that came to me. In some ways, it's a little bit more difficult tonight because Doug passed away on Friday. And I'm going to have to talk to him about something when I get there because I was supposed to go in 2 weeks to his house to watch March Madness. And I just have a feeling he knew that this year I was going to be one up him on the sheet, but he was not going to give me the joy. But I just need to share some things from him because after I came to know the Lord, I did a lot of analyzing in a human, why did this happen to me? Because when I gained eternal life, my heart was just filled with joy, but I wanted to know, how did this all happen? So I wanted to take a look at Doug's life. So I'm going to just take a few minutes and share with you some of my observations about Doug. Number one, Doug had yielded himself to the Lord to be used in any way the Lord saw fit to reach other people for Christ. He was always in the secular world. In the Air Force, then he started his own company after he got out, and he stayed that way until he got retired. He never was in the ministry. That was never God's intent with Doug. But he still wanted to reach people. Now, as I look at his life, first of all, he was yielded to the Lord. And you know, when this was Doug when I first met him, and you know, as I look at Doug, my life did not intersect with his at all when I first met him. Now, when I first met him, I worked at SAC headquarters in Bellevue, Nebraska, and he was a commanding officer of a shop that was right next to mine. We didn't intersect because our lives were so different. I mean, Doug centered on the Bible and church and wholesome family life, all of that was Doug. I'm on the other side. I'm single. I'm not married. I'm not saved. I spend my time in the bars and partying and having fun and all of that. So you can start to see those lives will never intersect, will they? And for the most part, they did not intersect. But I heard about Doug. One of my friends said to me, hey, I went to church with Doug and they had a really bizarre special music. They had an older lady whistling a song. He said it was, just be careful of Doug a little bit. But from that, I knew Doug was different, even though I didn't intersect. I could watch him from a distance. Really didn't have any desire to get to know him all that much. But I'll say one thing as far as if you don't intersect at all with an unsaved world, you will not reach anybody for Christ. Do you understand that? It says this about Jesus. The Word became flesh and took up residence with us. He intersected with us, didn't he? And you know, although I did not intersect with Doug for an entire year, it started to change. And you know, can I say, even before that, I was seeking on the inside, but I did not know what I was seeking for. I was a very faithful Roman Catholic, and I had studied to be a priest, dropped out of that, simply went my own way, and then when I was in the service, I started to have second thoughts saying, there's something wrong with me, but I don't know what it is. I would go to church every Sunday, but I came away empty. That was taking place before I ever met Doug. So I do want to say there is a sovereign God at work, and I say that because you could be working with some people just like that. Something was missing. And then in God's sovereignty, Doug became my commanding officer. He was over my section. So here's a guy who is open to God using him. Here's an unsaved guy that doesn't understand anything. But now God says, whoa, what I need to do is bring them together. So that's what God does. If you want to be used by God, understand there's a powerful, sovereign God that can make that happen. So he became my commanding officer. And so I started to see him at work all the time. And Doug was a special guy. He really had a great sense of humor. And he could poke fun at the way unbelievers would live. And yet he didn't alienate us. He just had a humorous way of doing it. He would make fun of some of the stupid things. And it was a fun conversation. And I enjoyed that about him. And he was an enlisted man before he ever became an officer, which gave him good insight into enlisted guys who I was one of them. Because a lot of officers just work their way up the ladder. They really don't have a lot of concern for the people underneath them. But Doug was an enlisted man. And so he understood. And so we would start to work, and then I worked with computers, which gives Doug probably nightmares. Are you kidding? He worked on techie stuff? Doug, oh, that can't be true. Of course, I worked in the day when they had punch cards and card readers and magnetic tape drives, and that room, what part of the room right there, it would take up the whole computer system that a simple computer does on its own. It was a different world, but I was a part of that world. We had to test code at night because the users would be on during the day, and so we would have to test our code to enhance programming at night. And oftentimes the commanding officers, they didn't always have to come in. Every once in a while they did, but not always. But here's Doug. So we got some code to test out, and Doug shows up when we're testing our code out. Not only does he show up, but, you know, Doug has a family, and Susie and his two sons, and so Doug shows up, but he shows up with a big brown paper bag filled with sandwiches, pop, things to eat, and so we'd sit down, and he'd have that stuff there. Now our worlds are starting to intersect even more, and I'm getting to know Doug now. I didn't know him before. I appreciated him even more, and great as he would do that, I just started to admire him. And it even went further because Doug loves sports. So he loved basketball. Well, I played basketball in high school. You said, are you sure you played? Yeah, I did, Joe. I did. I did play basketball. And we would have a great time in the basketball season. Just to show you his sense of humor, I remember one game that we were playing, and we had a substantial lead. And we lost the whole lead. We ended up with about 15 seconds left. We were ahead by 1 point. Doug calls a timeout. He's the coach player of the team. So we all go to the sidelines, and Doug looks at us, and he only says this. He said, you guys got yourself into this mess. Now you guys get yourself out. That's it? But in fact, I remember the end of the game because I had to in-ball the ball. There was only 15 seconds left. I had to bring the ball, and I threw the ball away. Then the other team came down, and they took several shots, and they missed the shots. We won the game. Every year, Doug and I would talk about that. We would laugh and laugh about that. But you see, he's intersecting into my world now. Now we're becoming friends. And after that basketball season was over, and then I went on to softball season, but right at the end of that season, one of my friends who was on the basketball team, he was an unbeliever as well, he said, Chuck, this is the time, let's throw a party. I said, yeah, I'm all in. And what are we going to, well, everybody on the team will invite. Yeah, let's do it. And hey, I'll invite Doug. He said, don't do it. I said, why not? Well, he's not going to have the kind of party. He's not going to want the kind of party that we're going to have. I said, but he's the coach. And this is what I want to say to you. I grew to respect Doug enough that I wanted him at that party. And I didn't care if his lifestyle was different than mine. I had a deep respect for him. That's intersecting with me. God was at work, I understand that, but I want you to understand, because I had heard from about Doug. Doug, there was probably 20 people in our office. I'm going to guess that Doug had witnessed to every single one of those people. He'd do it different. He would invite them over to the house. He would invite them to church. He'd take them out to eat. He would do things, but his goal was to bring the gospel to everybody in that office. And my number came up. So while I went up to Doug, I say, hey, Doug, we appreciate you being the coach of the team, and I know we didn't win any championship or anything like that, but hey, we're going to have a big get-together, and we'd like you to be there. I really would like you to be there. He said, well, Chuck, what kind of party? And then he had to say it. Is there going to be a lot of drinking at that party? Well, Doug, there probably will be, but I said, hey, you don't have to do that. You can just come and just be there. He said, thank you for asking me. I really appreciate that. He said, but I don't know if I really would honor the Lord being at that type of party with you guys. Hey, Chuck, could I ask you a question? Oh, yeah, sure, go ahead, Doug. See, by this time, we were friends. You understand why I do evangelism the way I do evangelism? I analyze this whole thing. I said, yeah, Doug, ask me a question. Chuck, if you were to die, do you know for sure that you go to heaven? No one ever cared for my soul enough to ask me that question before. It was a strange question to me. I had never heard that question before. And he said, you must have lived in a real sheltered life from evangelical people. I guess I did. I'd never heard it. And I said, Doug, hey, nice question. I don't know that. And nobody else knows that either. I said, Chuck, have you read the Bible very much? No, hey, Doug, I go to church every Sunday, Doug, but I don't read the Bible all that much. He said it talks about that in there. Because of that question, it so penetrated my heart. Because God was already at work, it bothered me to no end that he said he was going to heaven, and I, being a good Catholic, wasn't going. That bothered me. I'm going to my priest to talk to him, and I did. And Doug knew I did. I said, hey, I'm going to set up a time with the chaplain, and we're just going to, I'm going to talk to him about, yeah, go ahead. And I did. And so I sat and talked with the chaplain, had a great, great visit with him. And I said, I just got two questions. I said, I got this friend, Doug. He says he knows for sure that he's going to heaven. Is that even possible? And he said, Chuck, I admire the guy's faith, but no, that's not possible. I said, that's exactly what I thought. He said, I got one more question for you, Father, before I leave. Hey, you know, I talked to Doug and asked him a few questions. Should I keep asking him any questions about the Bible or spiritual things? Yeah, go ahead if you like, which is not the typical answer priests would give. But that's what he said to me. So I took him at his word, and I started to bombard Doug with questions, way out questions, dumb questions maybe, but always questions. And his response was, Chuck, there's a verse here if you would look up in such a book, in a chapter, in these verses, and read those, I think you're going to find the answer. He did that for several weeks with me. Every day I had questions for him, patiently showing me what salvation was like eventually. That's why I wrote the Bible study booklet that I did in the very format that I did. Well, eventually, as we got to the place, and I would go over to his house, and and I just want to say about the home, I was going to talk about homes. I had stuff to say, but I'm taking too long doing this, but I hope this gets the point across. Homes are a great place to evangelize. Being in homes, sitting down with people, working and talking with people, having a presentable home, that's what Doug did. And so one night after softball, basketball season, I went over to his house and started to ask him more questions about being saved. I love the term. And as he went through it, he explained it. And in his home, I heard again. He gave me ice cream. In his home, I heard the gospel. And right outside his backyard, I knelt down and said, God, I don't get it. I don't even understand this. But Doug's telling me, and your Bible's saying that I need to be saved. And so right now, Lord, I open up my heart to you. I want you to be my Savior and to guide my life from here on out. That was the end. And I got up, and it was raining outside, and I went back into Doug's house, and he asked me if I had made a decision. I said, well, the best I know how, I did. And he hugged me, and I don't think my dad ever hugged me that way. And he gave me some words of instruction that I appreciated. And then a few days later, he bought me the first Bible that I ever had. And he gave it to me. He told me where to read. I read in the Gospel of John, and I came across the verse. And many of you have heard me use that. Truly, truly, I say unto you, he that believes on me has everlasting life. And I read it, and I read it, and I read it. And I understood that belief was the way a person was saved. That's what I had looked at the other verses, and it was true. But the greatest thing was, has everlasting life. He that believes has it right now. And as I read it for about the 10th time, a joy filled my heart like I could never understand or ever experienced. And as that happened, I realized that I had eternal life, exactly what the Bible talked about. I was filled with joy to the place that I skipped in uniform out to my car down in the enlisted lot. It was way down there, but I didn't care. And I say that because that's when God filled my heart with gratitude that I could never turn back from. I couldn't believe that I had eternal life. I said, is there anything greater than this? I said, God, I don't know what you want to do with my life. But if somehow I could learn how to talk to people, that's what I'd like to do. And you know, as I look back at what Doug did, it was a simple thing. He was simply following God and what God wanted him to do. He was going to be in the right place. And God used Doug to reach a number of people like that. In fact, I had a friend the very next week after I was saved. I said, hey, Jim, come with me over to Doug's house. He's going to tell you what he told me. Well, okay, he went over there and Doug is talking to him and I'm watching Jim. And Jim falls down on his knees right in the house and accepts the Lord. I said, whoa, this is great. Jim and I became best friends. We got baptized together. We joined a church, and that's the church where Diane was. So that worked out. But that's not all. Doug was only there for about a month after I was saved, and he had to ship out to Thailand, but he never forgot me. And we would always connect when he'd come back to the States and live in different places. He was always around when I wanted to go to graduate school, and I didn't know how that worked. Doug said, "Hey, I think I can find you a job interview where you can go out to the Pentagon and work, and then you can go to school at the same time." And he set it up, and it worked out great. I was telling other people how that worked. It was just God, but Doug was involved in that. When we would have kids, sometimes Doug would call, "Hey, were you able to pay for all of the hospital bills?" And if we couldn't cover them, Doug would be there. When we were going to go to Ecuador, and he heard about it, he had started his own company called Mica Systems, and he jumped on, and normally it would take missionaries, 2 to 3 years to raise support, and Doug heard we were going, and he said, "I'd like to jump in," and he gave us a sixth of our support first day. It took us less than a year to raise the support we needed, you know. He was always there. Because, you see, when somebody comes to know the Lord, you don't just let him go. I mean, he was there. Not close, but he was always there. Probably the thing that I'll miss the most, he prayed for me every day. He's rejoicing. I'm happy for him. I'll miss his prayers and I'll miss his company, but I just want to give you a glimpse of somebody that knew how to intersect with the unsaved world. And when I watched what Doug did and analyzed, I said, "Oh God, I want to intersect with the unsaved world like what Doug did for me." And it's been a great joy to endeavor to do that. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to do that until God takes me home. And my prayer is that God will raise up numbers that will do the very same thing, because a sovereign God can use us because he is at work in lives out there. We just have to be willing, don't we? And build friendships with people and intersect with people and try to intersect, learn how to do that. And God can use each of our lives. Learn how to pray for one another. That's what we want to happen at Saylorville. We want to continue to intersect with people who have no hope at all. But they're searching. So I pray. I'd ask you to pray for Doug's family. I'm going to do the funeral out in West Virginia. And he has one son that's all forward, and another son not so much. And my prayer is that maybe at the funeral God might be able to reach him. I pray that that might be true. I sent a note out. I got some touching responses from South America. And in essence it said, "Chuck, we've heard you talk about Doug all the time. And we're thankful for Doug, and we're thankful for you." And one man wrote, "And we want to imitate you two, and someday we want to meet Doug in heaven." I pray that God would give us a heart to reach people. So let's just bow our heads as we finish up here. God, you know every heart here. And maybe you just cause us to reflect on the people that you used to bring the gospel to us. May our hearts be filled with joy for the salvation that we possess. May we realize we have something greater than the rest of the world has. May we always be thankful for it every day, every day. And Father, I pray that we would have hearts that would want to take the good news to others like it was brought to us. Because that's what your son did. That's what the Apostle Paul did. That's what the 12 apostles did. That's what many did in the early church. And that pattern has been going on for over 2,000 years. Don't let us cut it off. Help us to follow the very same pattern. And although there are times there are struggles in doing that, give us a love for lost people. Because we were very unlovely as well. I certainly was. So, Father, give us a heart for people. Help us to be involved in all three communities. Maybe you're here tonight, you're not having community with Christ. I pray that that would get started. That's crucial. You have no vibrant life without that. Maybe you're here tonight, you don't cherish your cell groups like you should and make them what they ought to be. I pray you'd help us with that and then help us to reach out to the unsaved world. Father, if there would be anybody here tonight who really doesn't know Jesus, then speak to their heart as well. Draw them to yourself. God, thank you for our church. Thank you for Pastor Pat and his great leadership. And it's a joy because we know this is the type of heart Pat has. I always encouraged with him as he shares, but raise up many others. Father, we have warmer weather coming our way. We have spring coming our way. We have Easter coming our way. We're going to be around our neighbors. And we don't know how to do this very well. But you can strengthen us and give us a love, a divine love for people that are not lovely, but they need to hear. And Father, even when people don't receive the news well or they stay distant from us, just help us to rejoice that we at least tried to plant the seed. There's great joy in planting seeds, great joy. And Father, may we know that joy as we reach out to others for your sake. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.